Good afternoon. I'm Greg Carty, Associate Dean for Research in the School of Kinesiology, and it's my pleasure to welcome you today to the 6th Annual Katarina T. Bohr Lectureship in Exercise Endocrinology and Metabolism. As I'm sure most of the audience knows, Professor Bohr is a distinguished scholar in the area of exercise endocrinology. The annual Bohr Lecture provides an opportunity to learn from the most accomplished contemporary scientists who are engaged in scholarship that provides novel insights about the involvement of hormones in exercise and metabolism and health and prevention of disease. The School of Kinesiology is extremely grateful to Professor Katarina Bohr and her husband, Dr. Paul Winger, for making this lectureship series possible. Today, we're also excited to welcome Dr. Henriette van Praag, a neuroscientist who has made a number of important contributions about the influence of exercise on the brain and behavior. She has recently performed some fascinating experiments that identify peripheral factors from tissues outside the brain that may play an endocrine role in the beneficial effects of exercise on learning and memory. Dr. van Praag is an associate professor of biomedical sciences at the Florida Atlantic University Charles E. Schmidt College of Medicine and the Stiles-Nicholson Brain Institute. Her research aims to understand the beneficial effects of exercise on brain function and behavior. In particular, her lab focuses on the exercise-induced increase in new neurons in the adult rodent dentate gyrus of the hippocampus, a brain area that is essential for learning and memory. Dr. van Praag received her PhD in biopsychology from Tel Aviv University, followed by postdoctoral training in neuroscience and cell biology at the Robert Wood Johnson Medical School. She then served as a staff scientist in the genetics laboratory at the Salk Institute of Biological Studies. Dr. van Praag started her own research group at the National Institute on Aging in 2007, from which she moved to Florida Atlantic University in 2018. Dr. van Praag has received numerous awards throughout her career, including the NIH Merit Award for Mentorship of Women Scientists in 2016. Additionally, she currently serves as co-editor-in-chief of the journal Brain Plasticity. We are delighted to have her virtually here today to share her expertise with us. Please help me to welcome Dr. Henriette van Praag.
So hi, I would like to very much thank Dr. Katarina Bohr and the committee to invite me to give this presentation today. I'm located at Florida Atlantic University in the Stiles-Nicholson Brain Institute on the Jupiter campus, as you can see, and I will be talking about the mechanisms underlying the beneficial effects of exercise for the brain. So this is, as you all know, a little overview of the human brain. Our research focuses on the hippocampus, a brain area that's essential for learning and memory. That's this blue piece here. So you also all know that neurons are the main components of the nervous system, and they are essential for motor, emotional, and sensory function. The hippocampus, as I already mentioned, is critical for learning and memory. It's located right here now. This is a little slightly different view, the coronal view. It is unfortunately also among the first areas affected by Alzheimer's disease with loss of neurons. However, this brain structure can also give rise to new neurons postnatally. And the phenomenon that we call adult neurogenesis was first described by Joseph Altman and colleagues in the 1960s. And he described two brain areas that can give rise to new neurons in the adult brain: the subventricular zone of the lateral ventricle of the hippocampus that gives rise to new neurons in the olfactory bulb, and the subgranular zone of the dentate gyrus of the hippocampus that gives rise to new granule cell neurons. So we can easily now label these newly born neurons by injecting a thymidine analog called bromodeoxyuridine, which labels any dividing cell in the body and brain. And here you can see coronal sections through the mouse dentate gyrus of the hippocampus with cells labeled with BRDU. These are these brown nuclei that you see, these brown dots. And then we can also do a triple labeling for a neuronal marker in green, BRDU here in red, and the glial marker S100 beta in blue. So this is immunofluorescence showing you the overlap between this, the marker for the neurons, the marker for BRDU. The orange tinted cells are cells that we consider to be adult born neurons in the adult brain. So these cells develop slowly in the adult brain. They progress from a proliferative state in the subgranular zone to migrate and then integrate into the dentate gyrus over a period of about 1 month. So as I just showed you with BRDU labeling, you can only see these cells sort of as nuclei, as dots. However, using a different methodology, retroviral labeling, we can actually see also the morphology of these cells when we have a retrovirus expressing GFP. So this is what the cells look like early on, about 2 days into their development. And this is what they look like a month later. And this is a technology by which we inject retrovirus expressing GFP directly into the dentate gyrus, and that allows us to visualize these newly born neurons and also to study their function to make electrophysiological recordings. I want to point out that these cells are only being generated in one subfield of the hippocampus in the dentate gyrus. So they are not throughout the hippocampus. So this is area CA1, which is devoid of newly born neurons. This is dentate gyrus, the first relay station in the hippocampus that contains these newly born neurons. So adult neurogenesis is not just unique in that it occurs in this one subfield. It is also unique in that it is highly regulatable. It can be upregulated by exercise, and down regulates with aging, stress, high fat diet, and excessive alcohol intake. The first study showing that adult neurogenesis could be increased was done by Gerd Kemperman and colleagues, 1997, who showed that when you house animals in a larger environment, a so-called enriched environment, with more opportunity for social interaction, physical activity, and learning, there are more new neurons. And when we set out to sort out which component of the enriched environment is responsible for this increase in neurogenesis, we found that the critical component is the running wheel. We refined that study a little bit more by sorting out the control, the running, an enrichment only and an enrichment plus running condition, because as you could see, the original study had a wheel in it. So this composition here shows you an empty cage, a cage only with running wheels, a cage only with toys, and a cage with toys and wheels. And indeed, what we observed is that only when running is included that there is this increase in adult neurogenesis. The toys alone is not sufficient to increase the number of new neurons. And this increase in adult neurogenesis is accompanied by an upregulation of BDNF, brain-derived neurotrophic factor, an important growth factor that supports the growth and survival of these newly born neurons. So what I've shown you so far is that exercise enhances adult hippocampal neurogenesis, the proliferation of these cells, the differentiation of the cells, and also their integration into the dentate gyrus of the hippocampus. What is the functional relevance of these cells? Could they contribute to the effects of exercise on learning and memory, or actually does exercise improve learning and memory? That's another aspect that we've researched quite extensively. So here we house animals either in a sedentary cage or with a running wheel, and then we study their behavior in the Morse water maze, a mouse memory task. In this test, mice learn to find a platform. As you can see, that's hidden just a little bit under the surface of the pool over a matter of several days. Initially, they have difficulty finding it. We have a 1 minute cutoff for each trial, about 4 trials per day. However, after about a week of training, they swim directly to the platform. And what we found at the time is that mice housed with a running wheel have a shorter path length and latency to the platform. And also, if you remove the platform after training, the runners will remember where it was located. They will search in the quadrant, in the red quadrant, where the platform was previously located. And we have shown that this effect of exercise on learning and memory extends not just to young mice, but also to middle-aged, and also to very aged animals. All animal age groups that we have tested, also males and females, show that after about 1 month of exercise, they perform better on this Morris water maze task. However, exercise is also important for other types of learning and memory. For example, running improves the ability to distinguish between highly similar events or stimuli. Why is this important? This aspect of our cognition is called pattern separation. And again, it's one of the first ones that declines with Alzheimer's disease or other neurodegenerative conditions associated with dementia. So this ability to distinguish between identical or highly similar or closely spaced stimuli is very important for our daily living. So for these studies, mice are trained to touch a screen, in a computerized screen, and to distinguish between two similar stimuli. And what we asked, of course, is enhanced neurogenesis associated with improved pattern separation. So mice learn to touch the screen for reward, and then they are challenged by either a large separation between stimuli or a small separation between stimuli. And what we find is that mice that are housed with a running wheel do better on this small separation, on being able to distinguish which of these icons is rewarded, than mice that are housed under sedentary conditions. So you can see here the trials to criterion for the small separation are less in the runners than in the controls. And also there is a trend between the number of new neurons that's being generated and the trials, number of trials to criteria. So what I've shown you so far is that running increases cell proliferation and neurogenesis in the dentate gyrus of the hippocampus. This is associated with increases in BDNF, an important neurotrophin, and also with improvements in different types of learning and memory. Now, one of the questions we asked is, if it is indeed the case that adult neurogenesis might be an underlying mechanism for these effects of exercise on the brain, is this just due to the local increase in these newly born neurons, or are they actually part of a network that may contribute to the effects of exercise on the brain? How far do these effects extend? So for this, we again use the retroviral method that I showed you a little bit earlier in the talk, that we used to label these dividing cells directly by injecting into the brain. And now we've made it specific for a rabies virus vector that can recognize these cells by binding to a avian receptor, the TVA receptor, that's expressed specifically in these newly born neurons. And then we are able to trace their direct inputs. So I won't go into too much of the detail of this, but this is just how the starter cell looks. They have a green nucleus, the rabies virus is in red. And what this allows us to do is basically to make a map, a little brain map of the inputs to these newly born neurons from different structures and how they develop over time from when the cells are about a week old until when they're 3 months of age. And gradually they get more connections. For example, when they're 4 weeks old, they get input from the entorhinal cortex, which is another area that's very, very important for learning and memory, and again, affected by Alzheimer's disease. So then after we establish this technology and map the circuitry under sedentary conditions, we ask, well, what happens with running? So again, here we inject our retrovirus expressing TVA and the rabies glycoprotein. And then after a month, we inject the rabies virus to trace the cells. And then a week later, we look at the inputs to the newly born neurons. And we have made an extensive analysis, but I will just show you one of the highlights, which is the exercise-induced increase in input from the entorhinal cortex onto these newly born neurons. So the cells in red that you see here, they are not newly born neurons. These are existing neurons in the entorhinal cortex, and they connect to these little newborn neurons in the dentate gyrus that you see here. And you see a huge upregulation, so potentially a strengthening of this pathway with exercise, suggesting that the effects of exercise on the brain are not just limited to this little area where neurogenesis occurs, but they extend throughout. So exercise increases entorhinal input to newly born neurons and also improves memory function. Again, as I showed you, there's an enhancement also of pattern separation. And again, if you make a lesion in this entorhinal area, you'll also diminish pattern separation ability. So to conclude what I've showed you so far, running increases the number of newly born neurons and also results in a rewiring of the network of these newly born neurons. So running increases adult neurogenesis, network plasticity, and learning and memory. But still, does that answer our question? Why does exercise improve cognitive function? So as I've shown you, there are things that happen inside the brain. More new neurons are being generated. The connectivity changes. I haven't shown you, but there is an upregulation of vascularization, angiogenesis. I mentioned BDNF is upregulated. There are changes in synaptic plasticity and also fine morphology. Cells have more spines, sometimes more branching, and there are also changes in neurotransmission. However, these are all changes within the brain. However, what happens outside of the brain? What are the underlying mechanisms? Are there peripheral factors? Is there an endocrine link potentially between muscle and brain? So there's some evidence for communication between the periphery and the brain. So for example, heterochronic parabiosis studies where the circulation of a young mouse is linked to that of an aged one has shown that there are factors in the blood of young mice that can promote adult neurogenesis in aged mice. Additionally, as I'll show you, there are compounds that can activate energy metabolism in skeletal muscle that may mimic the effects of exercise. And then we will be talking about peripheral factors produced by skeletal muscle, so-called myokines, that can contribute to the effects of exercise on the brain. So AMP kinase, as you all may know, is a master regulator of energy metabolism, important for energy balance, glucose homeostasis, mitochondrial function. And what was shown several years ago is that if you give a compound, an agonist of AMP kinase, ACAR, that improves endurance in sedentary mice. They run longer on a treadmill. So Tali Kobilo, postdoc in my lab, asked, does ACAR also mimic the central effects of exercise? Does it increase BDNF levels, adult neurogenesis? Does it affect mood or cognition? And indeed, what she and others showed was that there is an upregulation, for example, in the dentate gyrus with ACAR treatment of BDNF levels, not to the extent of running, but it still is an upregulation. In addition, ACAR enhances spatial memory and neurogenesis in young mice, provided it's given for a short period of time. It enhances retention of spatial memory in the Morse water maze, and it also increases neurogenesis. In addition, if we treat animals that have a mutation in the alpha 2 receptor of AMP kinase in muscle, the effect of exercise is precluded, suggesting that this compound, which barely crosses the blood-brain barrier, may exert its effects on the brain by muscle AMPK activation. And using this sort of as a working hypothesis, we thought that the benefits of exercise for cognition may, to some extent, originate from muscle. So then when postdoc Hayo Moon joined the lab, he decided to look at that in great detail. And he took ACAR, the same compound, and he applied it to L6 rat muscle cultures. So these are two dishes here, one treated with vehicle, the other one muscle cultures treated with ACAR. He collected the conditioned media and then treated adult hippocampal progenitor cell cultures or adult hippocampal stem cells. And what he found was that the vehicle conditioned media, there were few cells that differentiated into neurons. So TUJ1 is a marker for neurons, for young neurons. And whereas with the ACAR conditioned medium, there is a beautiful differentiation into these neuronal phenotype, suggesting that there is something in this conditioned media that is exerting this pro-neurogenic effect. So he then went on to analyze the contents of the conditioned media of the muscle cells treated with either vehicle or ACAR, and looked for differentially expressed bands. And then we did a mass spectrometry analysis of the particular differentially expressed band and found that there were several candidates or protein candidates that came out of that, and then decided on cathepsin B, a lysosomal enzyme, based on the size that it could be secreted, and that also that it was detected in one of our previous microarray analysis as being upregulated with exercise. So what he then found was that running increases cathepsin B levels in the gastrocnemius muscle. So this is after 1 month of running. And also that with exercise over time, there is an increase in plasma cathepsin B levels in running rodents, in running mice. then to see if there's any behavioral relevance of cathepsin B for cognitive function, we were lucky to obtain cathepsin B knockout mice. So these were housed either under sedentary condition or with a running wheel, and underwent a series of behavioral tests. So motor tests, open field behavior, coordination in the on the rotor rod. We examined mood, which is the here the elevated plus mace. Animals that are more anxious will spend more time in the closed arms than in the open arm. There's a sucrose test and a forced swim test, which are measures of depression. And then finally, our Morris water maze, which I've shown you already several times, where the animal has to find a platform that's hidden under the surface of the pool. So the main behavior that was affected was spatial memory. What we found was that in contrast to the wild type runners, which showed good retention of spatial memory in the Morris water maze, remembering where the platform was previously located after one day and 2 days after training, the knockout runners and the knockout sedentary animals had no retention of platform location, suggesting that their memory is affected. In addition, they did not show the expected increase in adult neurogenesis with running. This is a different marker. This is a marker called double cordon, an endogenous marker for newly born neurons that you can see here. And it is upregulated nicely in the runners, but not in the knockout animals with running. And then back into tissue culture, when he applied the recombinant cathepsin B to neural progenitor cells, found that there's an upregulation, again, of double cordon, same marker, marker for migration and immature neurons, and also an upregulation of BDNF, suggesting a link between cathepsin B and adult neurogenesis and learning and memory. So then we asked, does exercise increase cathepsin B plasma levels in other species? And also, is there any link to learning and memory? So we were fortunate to collaborate with Emre Düzel at DZNA at the University of Magdeburg in Germany, who had sent us blood samples of people that had been in an exercise trial. These were previously sedentary male and female college students. They range from 19 to 34 years of age. The controls were walking twice a week at 50% heart rate for about 10 to 15 minutes, whereas the exercise group was running three times a week at 70 to 90% heart rate for about an hour. The study duration was 4 months. And what we found was that the change in their VO2 was correlated with the change in cathepsin B. So increased fitness was associated with elevated cathepsin B plasma levels in humans. In addition, these people underwent a memory test. So this is called the Ray Ostrich complex sphere test. What it involves is getting a picture like this to copy onto a fresh piece of paper. And then half an hour later, paper gets taken away, and then to redraw it again from memory after half hour. So what was found was that people who had been training did better on this task than these sedentary controls, or at least there's an association between the change in cathepsin B and the change in the score on this test. Now, there's also a link or a potential link between cathepsin B and Alzheimer's disease. And this has been slightly controversial in the literature. There are researchers that suggest that if you inhibit Cathepsin B, it will treat Alzheimer's disease, but there are also several papers showing that cathepsin B has anti-amyloidogenic and neuroprotective functions. So we collaborated again with Dr. Ozioma Okonkwo at the University of Madison, Wisconsin, who did a study where he took older adults who are at risk for Alzheimer's disease, either due to having close family members who are affected or APOE4 genotype. And these people underwent a 6-month intervention of exercise. So either they had usual physical activity, such as the lady here walking the dog, or they spent 3 days a week exercising on the treadmill with gradually increasing intensity. And this intervention was already shown to improve cardiorespiratory fitness and also have some benefits for cognitive function. So what we did, we took the blood samples of people that were in this study and looked at their baseline levels of cathepsin B and also of other factors that have been implicated in exercise, peripheral BDNF, a longevity factor called Clotho, and also we performed a metabolomics analysis. And what we found was consistent with our study in young adults that in the EPA, the enhanced physical activity group, there was an upregulation of cathepsin B levels. So you can see here, no difference in the UPA group, but in the EPA group, there's an upregulation of cathepsin B. Whereas BDNF actually declines and Clotho does not change. In addition, what we found in this study was that cathepsin B is closely associated with hippocampus-dependent cognition. So people here did a verbal learning task, so where they have to remember lists of words. And what we found was that the change in cathepsin B in these older adults, so they were average age about 65, was significantly correlated with their performance on this task. So you can see here in orange are the runners. You can see also from the round circle that these are the females here that may have the biggest advantage. No change with BDNF and no change in association with Clotho. So as I mentioned in the study, we also looked at metabolites, in particularly mainly the lipid metabolites were the majority of the ones that were measured. And we find that in the same cohort of people, there is a decrease in plasma lipid metabolites that are associated with the conversion from minimal cognitive impairment to Alzheimer's disease with exercise. So ceramides, sphingolipids, their levels are reduced with exercise. And interestingly, this is closely associated with the change in BDNF levels. So here is just another example of several of these metabolites that are such as phosphoethanolamine that are choline phosphate that are reduced with exercise and are closely associated with the change in BDNF, suggesting they might regulate BDNF levels. So enhanced physical activity in these middle-aged adults that are at elevated risk for Alzheimer's disease is associated with increased plasma cathepsin B levels. There's a correlation between cathepsin B and memory function. There are lower levels of plasma BDNF and unchanged ClotHO. And there also is a lower level of lipid metabolites that are implicated in Alzheimer's disease. So we think this panel might give us some biomarkers in the blood that could be measures of how exercise affects the brain, and also how exercise might play a role in the delay or prevention of neurodegenerative conditions. So while I've focused mainly on myokines, so the factors that are released from muscle that affect the brain, there are also other factors that are being discovered probably as we speak that are derived not just from muscle, but also, for example, from the liver, such as IGF-1, GPLD1, from fat tissues, for example, adiponectin. And all of these researchers beginning to emerge have effects on neurogenesis, maybe involved the upregulation of neurotrophic factors, such as, for example, irisin, and also have an effect on brain blood flow, potentially. And of course, learning memory, as we already discussed. And these factors probably don't all work in isolation. So likely all our peripheral organs, the muscle, adipose tissue, liver provide these factors that in turn can influence neurogenesis, cognition, mood, synaptic plasticity, neurotrophin levels, all things that may mediate together the effects of exercise on the brain. So with that, I'd like to conclude that running increases neurogenesis and memory function. I've showed you that. I've also showed you that the effects of exercise are not just restricted to increasing the number of new neurons in the dentate gyrus, but also it expands the input, the network of these cells, and that the benefits of exercise for cognition and also for mood may in part originate from peripheral organs, for example, muscle, and then cathepsin B is a myokine that we discovered that is associated with memory function across species, so in both in mice and in young and in aged humans. And of course, there are many other peripheral factors that influence the brain that remain to be discovered. And then, of course, I want to thank the people in my lab that have performed all these experiments, and that some of whom now have their own lab. Heil Moon is a professor at Seoul National University, Carmen Vivar at Sin Vistav in Mexico City, and from my wonderful collaborators, Emra Duzel, Ziomo Konkwo, Xinyu Zhao, and Linda Kitabayashi, who is always helping us with our photomicrographs. And again, thank you to Dr. Katarina Bohr for this kind invitation, and for her and the committee for selecting me to give this talk. And I'd be happy to take any questions.